this one was just beautifully written and beautifully done. And I love the perspective it's from these two young men. Also, we don't see those type of friendships too among Black boys, to be honest with you. It was so innocent and it's so funny. Most of the guys I know that watch this movie are tearing up at the end.
So this question is for both of you. What initially drew you to this project and this film?
I would say for me, it was the opportunity to help usher forward a story like this that I hadn't seen. You know, I was so excited, the notion of telling a story through the eyes of two little boys and following their friendship and the evolution of that and how all these adult things are happening around them, but their point of view is what we are in, and we get to see, you know, the world through their eyes. Obviously, as a mom, I absolutely could relate to Dolores as a daughter of a single Black mom and then the granddaughter of a single Black working mom. I could relate. But also, I was drawn to the opportunity to work with Min Hall. You know, she's such a force, and I'm excited to see what she continues to contribute to the cinematic canon.
I love that. And I mean, for me, Chicago, being from Chicago, born and raised there, remembering that time period of when everything happened. And then when me and Hal had our first conversation, it was like, oh, you for real get it. Because right. Sometimes I'm a little nervous when people try to tell Chicago stories, to be quite honest with you. And this one was just beautifully written and beautifully done. And I love the perspective it's from these two young men. And also, we don't see those type of friendships too among Black boys, to be honest with you. It was so innocent and it's so funny. Most of the guys I know that watch this movie are tearing up at the end.
Yeah.
Because you forget how innocent those friendships were at that time, especially like being a young Black man. Also, I mean, we call it we grown now, but it's very interesting where like, I feel like, especially that time in the 90s, a lot of us was asked to grow up a little quicker than our parents probably wanted to, too, because of the situation. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to recognize like, dang, like I don't, you know, the gangs is real for real. The guns is on the street for real, for real.
Yeah.
And I mean, even it's a part of the movie when they ditch school, and it's like, oh yeah, I remember you could just run out the school.
Right.
They had an insurance officer then, like a guy walking around with a regular car looking for kids doing stuff. but it's a beautiful told story. And it really is a love letter to Chicago and to those residents in Cabrini Green.
And I think the film really shows how systemic issues, as you mentioned, were impacting Black families at that time and how parents really just wanted the best for their kids. Could you both talk about kind of exploring that theme, some of the experiences that you brought into it?
Oh, for me, I wanted to make sure I saw things from my dad's perspective in a way. It's a scene in the movie where, you know, we're doing a money count. And he's telling me that he went outside and jumped, and you know, and I could tell that particular dad, it was just like, I hear you, man, but I have no time to think about what you want me to participate in. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And especially in that situation, because you know, the mom is not around. And so it's a little more pressure on that guy. And we, you know, what's interesting too, and just also being a parent also, I think we forget how young our parents were. Making these type of decisions. Like they were like young, like late 20s, early 30s. That's not old. Like at that time it was old. But then when you become that, you're like, nah.
Right.
You have to make that type of decision. I don't know if I could do that now in my 40s to make some of the decisions y'all made, you know. So I like the fact that to dive into that and just the sense of maturity and just these mature conversations that we had to have with our on-screen sons is very interesting. I mean, even just the scene I love with you when he comes home and watching a parent have to be like, I'm mad, but I'm glad you're safe. Like, I want to choke you, but I want to hug you.
Right.
You know, it's just
And then I'm mad at you for putting me through this trauma, but I'm also glad I was put through this trauma for this reason that's not actually a serious reason, but now I gotta beat you.
It's like sometimes, you know?
I mean, look, not beat. I don't know. But I think, you know, for sure, I could relate to that struggle of, one, I'm raising a Black son, you know, and I want you to have your freedom. I want you to have your joy, and I want to protect that energy. Like, he's exploring, you know, he's accessing this level of curiosity, and he's the art institute, you know, like, yeah, I want you to love art, but, you know, how do I help you channel that energy? And how do I not beat your spirit down, you know? And how do I not make you so obedient that you don't, you're no longer a leader, but how do I also let you know you're a Black boy in America? You know, and so I know myself struggle constantly with, like, how do I calibrate this for my son? I want him to be his whole full self, and I want him to be audacious and bold, and I want him to go out in the world and not have limits and not be afraid to fly, but also, you know, and that talk that you got to have. And so I know, yeah, like, that scene still impacts me when I think about it. And I obviously drew on my own experience, but also I remember being a kid living in LA when the riots happened after Rodney King. Mm-hmm. And I remember my mom and my dad sitting my oldest brother Jojo down because he had just gotten his driver's license. And I remember them telling him, so this is how you have to, if you ever get pulled over, this is how you have to act. You know, like, having that talk. I vividly remember, I think it was like 5, 6, 7, I don't know. I was young, but I will always remember that they took him in and set him at the table, and they were whispering, but I overheard what they said, you know? And it's just so unfortunate that still in 2024, we, I'm delirious.
You know, what's interesting too, like, I think about having a conversation with my sons, and then I have to have a conversation with myself. Which is even crazier sometimes. Like, when I do, you know, you think about you've even if when you created a lifestyle, it's so interesting watching this movie and what my life is now and what that balance is. Like, hey, we're going to move here and it's going to be so much better. But then to be a Black man in America, a lot of times it ain't. Like, yeah, I bought this car.
Right.
Not from drug money or nothing. I've earned this correctly, but at the same time, I will get treated exactly the same way. It's just very, it's a crazy psychological game we have to play. And I love the fact that this movie does this beautiful way of, it's so beautiful that it helps me get back to the innocence of, okay, they just wanted to go see art.
Yeah.
I just want to jump on a mattress.
Yeah.
The mattress might be disgusting as well.